Let's say you're a member of a hunting tribe up in the mountains. Your tribe is great at making spears. They're solid, they're straight, and they've got a strong flint spearhead. But you don't get to do much gathering, so your baskets look like old birds' nests. Now, meanwhile, down in the valley is a gatherer tribe. Their baskets are woven tight enough to hold water, but their spears are a little better than wobbly sticks. Now, one day, a guy from the hunter tribe meets a guy from the gatherer tribe, and together they agreed to trade one of the hunter's excellent spears for one of the gatherer's top-notch baskets. They both go home, and the question now is, which one of them is wealthier? They both are, and that's the miracle. They both are returning with things that they and their tribe prize more highly than what they gave away simply because they are harder to obtain. They're rarer. But that's just the beginning, you see. The expert spear maker then realizes that if he gets up early and stays up late, he can make more spears than he needs for just himself. And he can trade that extra work for something he considers valuable, a basket, let's say. It motivates him to do more than he needs. The exact same thing is true of the basket weaver. And pretty soon, both of them are employing their idiot sons-in-laws manufacturing spears and baskets. Yes, the guy making and trading the spears gets relatively rich, but the fact is everybody wins. The idiot son-in-law, the guys making the flint spearheads, the entire hunter tribe gets the kind of baskets that they would never have had otherwise, and likewise for the gatherers with their awesome new spears. Now, for our progressive friends who feel that all wealth has to be stolen, yes, the guys with the spears could go out and kill all the gatherers and take all the baskets. And then there'd be no more baskets. Free trade is non-coercive. Both parties only get wealthier when both parties willingly trade what they have for what they want. Now, in a similar vein, some say that America is rich because it stole all of its wealth from the third world. Well, let's blow this silliness away just real quick. U.S. GDP is about $14 trillion. The GDP of a third world country, Djibouti, let's say, is about $1 billion. Now, America has 400 times as many people as Djibouti, but Americans don't just produce 400 times what Djibouti produces. We produce 14,000 times as much as they do. If we sent in the U.S. Marines to take every single thing Djibouti produced in 1 year, just took every single thing, their entire GDP, well, that would power the U.S. economy for 38 minutes of the first hour of the first day of America's GDP year. If we took everything from the bottom 40 countries, it might run the U.S. economy for a day or two. The whole idea is ridiculous, at least to people who know how to add, subtract, multiply, and divide. My friends, whenever two parties make a free will trade, spices for wool, or grain for firewood, or even $3.50 for a Happy Meal, both sides benefit because the customer would rather have the hamburger and McDonald's would rather have the $3.50. Now, you're welcome to disagree with me, of course. You can email me a comment on why you hate business and corporations using your Apple computer while you sit at Starbucks and send messages down AT&T phone lines to YouTube servers running Hitachi hard drives, all of which is powered by something like Consolidated Edison, most likely generating electricity by burning oil provided by ExxonMobil. Now, if you want to hand deliver a message scratched on a tree bark using a sharp stick while wearing a grass skirt, I will be much, much more impressed with your moral outrage.
One of the most pressing choices facing modern economies is whether to adopt a policy of free trade or of protectionism. That is, whether to encourage foreign goods into the country with minimum tariffs and allow industries to relocate abroad, or whether to make it hard for foreign firms to sell their goods internally and discourage domestic producers tempted by cheaper wages in other lands. It feels like a very modern dilemma, but the debates between proponents of free trade and protectionism go back a very long way. The argument began in earnest in Europe in the 15th century, with the formulation of a theory known as mercantilism, the forerunner of what we today refer to as protectionism. Mercantilism was, like nearly every other economic theory, interested in increasing a nation's wealth. But mercantilists argued that in order to grow richer, a country had to try to make as many things as possible within its own borders and reduce to an absolute minimum any reliance on foreign imports. The role of government was to help local industries by applying huge tariffs on imported goods and discouraging foreign manufacturers from competing with local players. A strong country was one that knew how to provide for itself and could achieve almost total independence in trade, a goal known as economic autarky. The philosophy of mercantilism reigned supreme as the most persuasive theory of economics until the 9th of March, 1776, the publication date of possibly the most important book in the history of the modern world. In An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, the Scottish philosopher and economist Adam Smith attempted to dynamite the intellectual underpinnings of mercantilism. Smith argued that the best way for any country to grow wealthy was not to try to make everything by itself, for no country could ever hope to do well in every sector of an economy. Smith observed that countries naturally had different strengths in particular areas. Some were great at making wine, others had talent in pottery, others still might be experts at making lace, and it was on such strengths that every country should focus. This was an application at the level of nations of a theory we can understand well enough at the level of individual life. If someone has a natural aptitude for accountancy, it makes no sense for them to spend a considerable part of each day trying also to make cheese, to sew their own trousers, or to learn to play violin sonatas. Far better for the accountant, cheesemaker, tailor, and violinist to specialize in the areas in which they have the greatest advantage and then trade with others to satisfy their remaining needs. As Smith noted, it is the maxim of every prudent master of a family never to attempt to make at home what it will cost him more to make than to buy. Smith emphasized that if Britain could produce woolen goods more cheaply than Portugal, and if Portugal could produce wine more cheaply than Britain, then it would be beneficial to both parties to exchange the product they could make at a lower cost for the one they could only make at a higher cost. The overall wealth of both countries would rise as labour and capital would always be optimally employed, directed to those sectors where native skill and opportunity was at its greatest. The job of the government was to recognise sectors where there was a national advantage, assist in the education of the workforce, but otherwise reduce tariffs as much as possible and step out of the way. With astonishing speed, Smith's theory convinced most of the economic and political classes of northwestern Europe. In Britain, his ideas were first put to a practical test in relation to the primary foodstuff of the nation, corn. Grain prices had for many years been protected by government decrees. Cheaper foreign grain had been kept out, apparently in order to protect jobs and national wealth. But Smith's ideas, now driven forward by his foremost disciple David Ricardo, proposed that all tariffs on imported grain, protectionist measures known as the Corn Laws, were in fact obstacles to economic growth. After bitter debates in Parliament, the laws were repealed in 1846. The result demonstrated both the advantages and incidental costs of Smith's ideas. The price of corn dropped sharply, food became cheaper, and everyone, especially the working classes, had a lot more spare money to spend on other goods. This, in turn, grew the overall size of the British economy, so that it significantly outperformed all of its European counterparts. But, and it was a very big but, large swathes of British agriculture went to the wall. Cheap imported corn from Canada and the United States destroyed farms and ways of life that had persisted for centuries. Smith's theories were both correct and, depending on where one was standing, plainly agonizing.
We're losing our jobs to China, to Japan, to every country. We're making horrible trade deals.
We have lost almost 60,000 factories since 2001 and millions of decent paying jobs.
I'll be the greatest jobs president that God ever created. I'll take them back from China, from Japan, from Mexico.
PNTR with China has led to the loss, led to the net loss of over 2.1 million American jobs.
We have got to stop sending jobs overseas.
argument for free trade is basically a very, very simple argument. In every country, it always is and must be in the interest of the great body of the people to buy whatever they want of those who sell it cheapest.
If you think about it, many of the great inventions of the last 200 years were designed to replace human labor. Tractors were developed to substitute mechanical power for human physical toil. Assembly lines were engineered to replace inconsistent human handiwork with machine perfection. Computers were programmed to swap out error-prone, inconsistent human calculation with digital perfection. These inventions have worked. We no longer dig ditches by hand, pound tools out of wrought iron, or do bookkeeping using actual books. And yet, the fraction of US adults employed in the labor market is higher now in 2016 than it was 125 years ago in 1890, and it's risen in just about every decade in the intervening 125 years. This poses a paradox. Our machines increasingly do our work for us. Why doesn't this make our labor redundant and our skills obsolete? Why are there still so many jobs? I'm going to try to answer that question tonight. And along the way, I'm going to tell you what this means for the future of work and the challenges that automation does and does not pose for our society. Why are there so many jobs? There are actually two fundamental economic principles at stake. One has to do with human genius and creativity. The other has to do with human insatiability, or greed, if you like. I'm going to call the first of these the O-ring principle, and it determines the type of work that we do. The second principle is the never get enough principle, and it determines how many jobs there actually are. Let's start with the O-ring. ATMs, automated teller machines, had two countervailing effects on bank teller employment. As you expect, they replaced a lot of teller tasks. The number of tellers per branch fell by about a third. But banks quickly discovered it also was cheaper to open new branches, and the number of bank branches increased by about 40% in the same time period. The net result was more branches and more tellers. But those tellers were doing somewhat different work. As their routine cash handling tasks receded, they became less like checkout clerks and more like salespeople, forging relationships with customers, solving problems, and introducing them to new products like credit cards, loans, and investments. More tellers doing a more cognitively demanding job. There's a general principle here. Most of the work that we do requires a multiplicity of skills. And brains and brawn, technical expertise and intuitive mastery, perspiration and inspiration, in the words of Thomas Edison. In general, automating some subset of those tasks doesn't make the other ones unnecessary. In fact, it makes them more important. It increases their economic value. Let me give you a stark example. In 1986, the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded and crashed back down to Earth less than 2 minutes after takeoff. The cause of that crash, it turned out, was an inexpensive rubber O-ring in the booster rocket that had frozen on the launch pad the night before and failed catastrophically moments after takeoff. In this multi-billion dollar enterprise, that simple rubber O-ring made the difference between mission success and the calamitous death of 7 astronauts. An ingenious metaphor for this tragic setting is the O-ring production function named by Harvard economist Michael Kramer after the Challenger disaster. The O-ring production function conceives of the work as a series of interlocking steps, links in a chain. Every one of those links must hold for the mission to succeed. If any of them fails, the mission or the product or the service comes crashing down. This precarious situation has a surprisingly positive implication, which is that improvements in the reliability of any one link in the chain increases the value of improving any of the other links. Concretely, if most of the links are brittle and prone to breakage, the fact that your link is not that reliable is not that important. Probably something else will break anyway. But as all the other links become robust and reliable, the importance of your link becomes more essential. In the limit, everything depends upon it. The reason the O-ring was critical to Space Shuttle Challenger is because everything else worked perfectly. If the Challenger were kind of the space era equivalent of Microsoft Windows 2000, the reliability of the O-ring wouldn't have mattered because the machine would have crashed. Here's the broader point. In much of the work that we do, we are the O-rings. Yes, ATMs could do certain cash handling tasks faster and better than tellers. But that didn't make tellers superfluous. It increased the importance of their problem-solving skills and their relationships with customers. The same principle applies if we're building a building, if we're diagnosing and caring for a patient, or if we are teaching a class to a room full of high schoolers. As our tools improve, technology magnifies our leverage and increases the importance of our expertise and our judgment and our creativity. And that brings me to the second principle. Never get enough. You may be thinking, okay, O-ring, got it. That says the jobs that people do will be important. They can't be done by machines, but they still need to be done. But that doesn't tell me how many jobs there'll need to be. If you think about it, isn't it kind of self-evident that if once we get sufficiently productive of something, we've basically worked our way out of a job? In 1900, 40% of all US employment was on farms. Today, it's less than 2%. Why are there so few farmers today? It's not because we're eating less. A century of productivity growth in farming means that now a couple of million farmers can feed a nation of 320 million. That's amazing progress, but it also means there are only so many O-ring jobs left in farming. So clearly, technology can eliminate jobs. Farming is only one example. There are many others like it. But what's true about a single product or service or industry has never been true about the economy as a whole. Many of the industries in which we now work, health and medicine, finance and insurance, electronics and computing, were tiny or barely existed a century ago. Many of the products that we spend a lot of our money on, air conditioners, sport utility vehicles, computers and mobile devices, were unattainably expensive or just hadn't been invented a century ago. As automation frees our time, increases the scope of what is possible, we invent new products, new ideas, new services that command our attention, occupy our time, and spur consumption. You may think, some of these things are frivolous. Extreme yoga, adventure tourism, Pokemon Go, and I might agree with you. But people desire these things, and they're willing to work hard for them. The average worker in 2015, wanting to attain the average living standard in 1915, could do so by working just 17 weeks a year, one-third of the time. But most people don't choose to do that. They are willing to work hard to harvest the technological bounty that is available to them. Material abundance has never eliminated perceived scarcity. In the words of economist Thorsten Veblen, invention is the mother of necessity.
An enduring problem for the undoubtedly very sound arguments in favor of free trade is that its human costs have seldom been addressed with sufficient passion and ingenuity. The cries of the dispossessed have not been recognized for what they are, threats to the entire stability and moral dignity of a nation. As has only gradually been realized, the benefits of an open economy can only properly bear fruit if a series of steps are taken to mitigate the attendant downsides. Any nation committed to free trade must tax the sectors of the economy which have an advantage and then use the money to retrain those in the sectors of the economy with the gravest disadvantages in relation to foreign competition. Without such redirection of money and labour, a nation will become highly unstable politically, thereby endangering any progress that free trade has made. Secondly, governments must enable everyone in the economy to find their own natural areas of strength, which means high levels of investment in education and a raft of measures to maximize social mobility.
These youngsters are beginning another day at one of America's public schools, Hyde Park High School in Boston. What happens when they pass through those doors is a vivid illustration of some of the problems facing America's schools. They have to pass through metal detectors. They're faced by security guards looking for hidden weapons. They're watched over by armed police.
The teachers who teach here don't like this kind of situation. The students don't like to come here to go to school. And most of all, the parents, they are the ones who get the worst deal. They pay taxes like the rest of us, and they are just as concerned about the kind of education that their kids get as the rest of us are. They know their kids are getting a bad education, but they feel trapped. Many of them can see no alternative but to continue sending their kids to schools like this.
Children like Ava are being shortchanged by a system that was designed to help them. But there are ways to give all parents more say over their children's schooling. This is one of the poorest neighborhoods in New York City, the Bronx. Yet this parochial school, supported by the fund, is a joy to visit.
Boys and girls, we're going to start the workshop now. You start out with task one, put the words in alphabetical order. The answers are on my...
The youngsters here, from poor families, are at St. John Chrysostom's because their parents have picked this school. And their parents are paying some of the costs from their own pockets. The children are well-behaved, eager to learn. The teachers are dedicated.
Behavior, consistent, contrary, destruction.
How old are you, honey?
Six.
Six. What are you working on?
The cost per pupil here is far less than in the public schools. Yet on the average, the children are two grades ahead. That's because teachers and parents are free to choose how the children shall be taught. Private money has replaced tax money. And so control has been taken away from the bureaucrats and put back where it belongs. This is Ashford, a town in the south of England. For 4 years, there have been efforts here to introduce an experiment in greater parental choice. Parents would be given vouchers covering the cost of schooling. They could use the voucher to send their child to any school of their choice. I have long believed that children, teachers, all of us, would benefit from a voucher system. But the headmaster here, who happens also to be secretary of the local teachers' union, has very different views about introducing vouchers.
We see this as a barrier between us and the parent. This sticky little piece of paper in their hand, coming in and under duress, you will do this or else. We make our judgment because we believe it's in the best interest of every Willie and every little Johnny that we've got, and not because someone's going to say, if you don't do it, we will do that. It's this sort of philosophy of the marketplace that we object to.
In other words, Mr. G objects to giving the customer, in this case the parent, anything to say about the kind of schooling his child gets. Instead, the bureaucrats should decide.
We are answerable to parents through our governing bodies, through the inspectorate to the Kent County Council, and through Her Majesty's inspectorate to the Secretary of State. These are people, professionals, who are able to make professional judgments.
But things look very different from the point of view of parents. Jason Walton's parents had to fight the bureaucracy, the professionals, for a year before they could get him into the school that they thought was best suited to his needs.
As the present system stands, I think parents have got no freedom of choice whatsoever. They are told what is good for them by the teachers. They are told that the teachers are doing a great job, and they've just got no say at all.
Those great new charter schools we showed you, I just wish there were more of them, more competition, because competition makes everybody better. But there are some people who don't like my saying that.
Shame on you! Shame on you! Shame on you! the teachers' union, 5 million members strong.
Shame on you! Shame on you!
This group is mad at me.
We are here to demand an apology from 2020's John Stossel.
I had done another show called Stupid in America that said it was impossible to fire bad teachers. The union boss said, because of my program.
Educators all over the country feel that they have been kicked in the teeth.
They were surprised when I came outside to hear them. The union said I should be educated.
So just teach for a week. We got high scores, we got elementary scores.
The crowd liked the idea of me teaching for a week.
Teach or teach! Teach or teach!
I think I surprised them again when I said, okay, I'll teach. But then they changed their mind. Union President Randy Weingarten won't talk to me anymore, but two other union bosses did. Joe Del Grasso, head of Newark's Teachers Union, and Nathan Saunders of Washington, D.C.'s.
City schools are terrible because of unions like yours.
Well, I would disagree. We have progress as a result of unions.
Save our school!
3 days before, Saunders led this protest march to complain about plans to pay teachers based on how well their students do on tests. The protesters even composed an anti-test song. I think I know why the union doesn't like testing.
Your results are awful. They're among the lowest in the nation.
You make an argument that it's the lowest in the nation based upon the test scores. Now, I would say that ours can get better, but I would say that ours are...
Your predecessors, the unions, have been saying that for years.
I think the unions have a pretty strong history of advocating for high-quality public education.
But not achieving it.
Higher test scores are not what we choose to focus on. We choose to focus on teaching kids.
But how do you know if they're learning anything if you don't test them and compare?
I know my kids are learning when I look in their eyes.
It's not about the money.
Kevin Chavis is a former D.C. politician.
When I was chairman of the Education Committee on the D.C. Council, I gave the school system $300 million new dollars. Teachers got more money than ever to educate 10,000 fewer kids, and the test scores went down. Now, what they did do, they grew center office. They had more deputies to the assistant to the deputy to the assistant. They grew the bureaucracy.
And the former district chancellor, Michelle Rhee, found that the bigger bureaucracy didn't even get school supplies to the kids.
Walking into schools and seeing that there were no books in the library, kids didn't have supplies and pencils, and then the following week I visited the warehouse of the school district where there were boxes and boxes of books and scissors and glue. And
so why didn't they get to the school?
Exactly. That was the question. That
well, why didn't they get to the school?
It was just a complete and utter sense of dysfunction and the lack of accountability.
Creativity, complexity, and free trade make people wealthy. We conservatives believe that this is the great miracle of a free country and a free people, and that the government is not capable of doing any of this. All that the government can do is regulate, constrict, and take away. Now, some regulations are good and appropriate, and some tax dollars are necessary, but every time we put the miracle of wealth creation in back of, rather than in front of, the government, ruin will surely follow.
Jobs are a means, not the ends in themselves. People work to live better, to put food on the shelves. Real growth means production of what people demand. That's entrepreneurship, not your central plan.
My solution is simple and easy to handle. It's spending that matters. Why is that such a scandal? Money sloshes through the pipes and the sluices. Revitalizing the economy's juices. It's just like an engine that's stalled and gone dark. To bring it to life, we need a quick spark. Spending's the lifeblood that gets the flow going. Goes doesn't matter, just get spending flowing.
You see slack in some sectors as a general glut, but some sectors are healthy, only some in a rut. So spending's not free, that's the heart of the matter. Too much is wasted as cronies get fatter. The economy's not a car, there's no engine to stall. No expert can fix it, there's no it at all. The economy's us, we don't need a mechanic. Put away the wrenches, the economy's organic.
Which way should we choose? Both bottom up or more top down? The fight continues. Gazing high, it's second round. It's time to win. Both on the top or
those unemployed? This is the question you seem to avoid. When we're in a mess, would you have us just wait, doing nothing until markets equilibrate? I don't want to do nothing, there's plenty to do. The question I ponder is who plans for whom? Do I plan for myself or leave it to you? I want plans by the many, not by the few. Let's not repeat what created our troubles. I want real growth, not a series of bubbles. Stop bailing out losers, let prices work. If we don't try to steer them, they won't go berserk. Come on, are you kidding? Don't Wall Street gyrations challenge a worldview of self-regulation? Even you must admit that the lesson we've learned is more oversight's needed or else we'll get burned. Oversight? The government's long been in bed with those Wall Street execs and the firms that they bled. Capitalism's about profit and loss. You bail at the losers, there's no end to the cost. The lesson I've learned is how little we know. The world is complex, not some circular flow. The economy's not a class you can master in college. To think otherwise is the pretense of knowledge.
Situation we choose.
And you're off to the races. I look at the world on a case-by-case basis. When people are suffering, I roll up my sleeves and do what I can to cure our disease. The future's uncertain, our outlooks are frail. That's why free markets are so prone to fail. In a volatile world, we need more discretion, so state intervention can counter depression.
People aren't chessmen, you move on a board at your whim, their dreams and desires ignored. With political incentives, discretion's a joke. Those dials are twisting, just mirrors and smoke. We need stable rules and real market prices so prosperity emerges and cuts short the crisis. Give us a chance so we can discover the most valuable ways to serve one another.
Which way should we choose?